and welcome. It is good to be here with you today. I have just a couple of announcements to make. If you could remember to fill out your red pew pad, you'll find that in your seats there and get that something scratched in there. We'd love to follow up with you, especially if you are a visitor with us here today. Also, you can check in with us on Facebook. That's another way to do that. If you'd rather do it that way, that's okay. Welcome. If you're viewing through the TV or internet, we're glad that you're here with us. And let's see. Also, I want to announce that this Thursday is our National Day of Prayer. It's the first Thursday in the month of May every spring, and that will be this Thursday. We're heading into May. So it's May this Thursday, and that will be at 7 o'clock p.m. at the middle school. And so it'll be in the cafeteria there. So 7 o'clock p.m. I think that's the second, right? It's May 2nd, yeah. 7 o'clock at the middle school, National Day of Prayer. We have pastors from around the area. We'll be praying for a few different categories, and we're going to have a few songs to sing opening up, and this should be out of there by 8 or 8:30. We invite you to come and be a part of that with us. Are there any other announcements as we get rolling here? Good morning, Becky. Okay. All right. Thank you, Becky. Any others? All right. Invite you to stand with us. We sing our opening song, Carry Me on Your Back. You to bow with me. We open in prayer. Dear God, we are thankful to be here today in your presence with your people, God, lifting up your name with one voice collectively, God, recognizing you as our God and King, our risen Savior, God. We thank you for this life that we have with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Name, care to feel my hurt.
bright and morning star, would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are.
Invite the children to come forward at this time, if you would. Hey, Nick, could you bring that seat over for me when you come back? Good morning. I have a story to tell you guys this morning. And like all of my stories, this is a true one. Now, Mr. Skip and Mr. Gary up there have a picture for us. The first picture I want to see is, yeah, that's the one. You've got it. Can you guys see what that is very well? Yeah, it's a frog. And so I've got a story about this frog. This really is a true story. So I came back from dropping Amelia off at school one morning here about 2 months ago, and it was one of those days where it was real, real warm the day before, and then it dropped way, way below freezing, like down to 20 degrees. That night, and I was out in the driveway, and I walked across, and I looked, and here's that frog laying in the middle of my driveway, and I thought, what is a frog doing out in 20-degree weather, because we know it freezes at 32, and it's below that, and so I thought, boy, that frog's got to be dead, right? And so I reached down, I picked it up, and it just felt like a children's toy, like a piece of plastic, just felt all dried out and hard, and so I looked at it, and I thought, boy, that's really weird. That thing must have been out in the warm weather, got caught in the cold and froze before it could get clear across my parking lot back into the leaves and stuff. And so I thought to myself, you know, I do know that there are certain kind of frogs that can survive this type of thing. So I took it in the house and put it in that Tupperware and took a picture of it just because I wasn't sure what was going to happen. But I took a picture of it. You can see already in this picture, it's starting to get a little bit of a green tint. Well, within about an hour, that thing started blinking its eyes and breathing, and Amelia, or Avery, was there with me, and we watched this thing come out of that frozen state to be a frog again, doing what frogs do. And so if you look at this next picture, I took a picture of it. There it is, hanging onto my finger. It turns out it's a tree frog. Yeah, and if you've ever seen their feet, they've got like suction cups on the end of their toes. They're really neat frogs. But this thing was alive. I was just blown away. So it was so surprising to me that I also took a video of it just to show how alive it is. I think they can play that video for us here this morning. Yeah, you can see it.
Here's this little frog we found in the driveway froze this morning. It's a little eastern gray tree frog, and he is alive and healthy.
I think it's a toad.
No, it's a frog. We better grab him before he
goes in a fake this house.
There you go. Here he is. Here, climb up on my finger, buddy.
Keeps hopping around.
A cute little thing. He has real sticky feet.
Yeah, I see his eye open.
He might jump on your face.
Isn't that neat? And so I just wanted to use that for an illustration. Now, there's a couple different things we can talk about that, but one thing that I want to talk about, if God, and I'm sure he did, created frogs and lizards and snakes and grass and people and children and babies, if God created all of these things, and if he could create a frog that can go into a completely frozen state and then bring it back out of that and be alive in the spring, it's just brings a whole lot of other things just into perspective for me to be able to understand how easy it is for God to do all kinds of things. And then I also think about that being in the spring of the way Jesus was brought back to life. Now, Jesus wasn't just frozen or sleeping. He was dead. It wasn't that he got thawed out like this frog and came back to life that way. He was dead for 3 days. And God raised him back up. And that's a neat reminder. And also one other thing that we can draw from this is before we know Jesus, we kind of have a cold heart. And that's figuratively speaking, meaning we have a cold heart. We don't know how to love people like we should. We don't know how to do the right thing because our heart, it's almost like it's frozen. And when Jesus comes into our hearts, he melts that cold heart. And we start to learn what it means to love people and to love God and to live as we should and really live life. Isn't that kind of neat? Let me pray for you. God, I thank you for these children. I thank you just for the illustrations of and evidence, God, all around us of you, our creator. But God, you didn't just create us. You loved us enough to take our punishment upon yourself, God, to deal with something that so we wouldn't have to. God, we thank you. I ask that you would bless these children. Continue to raise them in your love, God, in your ways. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, are you ready to do children's collection? All right.
fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar, the fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival.
Want to know why a sauce?
Thank you, Greg. I invite you to pray with me. God, as we take this moment, a very worshipful act, God, of giving to you. And God, we give for so many reasons, God, just first and foremost out of obedience and also out of thankfulness, God, and out of hope and anticipation. God, we ask that you would bless these gifts, God, that they would be used for you, for your kingdom, God, and that your gospel, your good news of your message for us. For mankind, God, could be spread and shown and shared throughout this community. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. So when we're praying for one another, this isn't just an exercise for me to pray for you. This is a time that we can pray for one another together. And some days we have a lot of things to pray for, and other days just a few, but there's no way that I'm going to remember these. This is just, I know how this works with my short-term memory. I'm not going to get them all. So I'll pray, and then we'll just have a moment of silence and just pray quietly for one or two of these prayer requests that have been lifted this morning. We'll just take that moment to pray for one another, and I'll open us if you pray with me. God, we do thank you that we can come together as a body, God, and share joys and things that we consider victories, God, that we see you working in and through our lives. God, that we can just be the hands and feet and face of Jesus to one another. And God, these prayer requests this morning and joys, God, we just lift them up to you, first of all, saying thank you for the ways that we see you working, and also, God, trusting you to work in these areas that maybe there's fear or uncertainty, but God, we know that you are a God who is aware of all. So God, we place these into your hands at this time. Holy God, we do thank you for hearing our prayers. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
You know, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We want to welcome you to worship today. Glad you're able to be with us. And glad that you've decided that you worship on the Sunday after Easter. I like that. And delighted that you're able to be with us. I was just whispering to Jerome a little earlier how I'm more relaxed on this day than I was last week. I loved last week, but I also love this week, and to be able to look into your eyes and know that because of the resurrected Jesus, you are here as well, and I'm encouraged by you and by that. The scripture this morning is taken from Acts chapter 12. I'm going to begin in verse 13. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, "Peter is at the door." "You're out of your mind," they told her. When she kept insisting that it was so, they said, "It must be his angel." But Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. "Tell James and the brothers about this," he said, and then he left for another place. This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen. Today I'm beginning a series of messages on why not women? Obviously talking about the leadership potential of women and how God has used them over the ages and how God's using our women today, and maybe even address a little bit of the biblical challenges that come along with culture, comes with sometimes the gender issues as to when men are in charge and when women are in charge. But mostly what I'm looking forward to is going through the Bible and lifting up the names of women that I haven't preached on nearly as often, and just seeing how God has used them in ways that sometimes comes under the radar for you and for me. I want to leave that book before you. And by the way, the book that I'm reading right now is called Why Not Women? I have that in front of you. Lauren Cunningham and David Hamilton are the authors of that. Lauren Cunningham and his wife Darlene were the founders of YWAM, Youth with a Mission. When I say that, I always feel like I have a speech impediment even when I try to say that, okay? YWAM, YWAM, Youth with a Mission. Our own Cinnamon, of course, worked with them 6-7 years, I believe. And so Lauren Cunningham was a founder along with his wife. And it's interesting, by the way, that they're very careful to say co-founders of YWAM. And for 40 years before the time of this book, they had traveled all over the world, probably in almost every country. I think there was one or two that they had not been into, in which they were looking as missionaries how to effectively share the gospel. And I think it's interesting that he had learned that one of the first places where women were given leadership positions was on the mission field. Now, why do you think that is? It's because the men wanted to be in charge of culture back home, but they were willing to let the women go to a foreign land and be in charge there. When I spent the summer in Bolivia, when I was 20 years old, there were, in that part of Bolivia where I was at, there was a woman who was in charge of the World Gospel Mission missionaries. And she was really very effective. And she knew very much that if she were back in the United States at that time, that she would not be one of the recognized leaders in that mission. Interesting, isn't it? I think my awareness of, you know, I grew up with a gender bias of men in leadership. In all honesty, the best Bible teachers in my church growing up were the women. My aunt was one of them. My mother was another one. There, I can name you 4 or 5 women who probably taught me the scriptures better than anyone in that whole place. But we had a pecking order with how the leadership roles took place in that church. And the men usually had those leadership roles. They usually made the final decisions on finances and things like that in the life of the church. when I began to be aware of this particular thing was whenever I'm raising my own children. And I wanted to just let you know, even as we named our children, when my first was born, we named him Peter. That's a good name. I like that name. His name is Peter, and we put his middle name as Wilson. You'll like that one, Karen. His middle name was Wilson because his mother was a Wilson. So that was a family name, and we wanted to reflect that family name. When Micah was born, and I wanted to get back to the tradition in the Reitz family, where you give your sons the middle name of the father. So Micah was stuck with the name. Get this, was stuck with the name. Says Micah Larry, just really flows off the tongue, doesn't it? And he told me, he said he had to be an adult before he could embrace that name. But think about that, how we name it. Then my daughter comes along, we're excited to have her. And we named her Whitney Janae. A time came along when she was old enough to be hearing all the Bible stories. She says, "Well, Dad, I know where Peter is in the Bible, and I know where Micah is in the Bible. Where is Whitney?" And it dawned on me for the first time, we had picked names, whether we were conscious of it or not, we had picked names that reflected the great men of the Bible, but when it came to our daughter, we neglected to consider the possibility of which names. We knew Jezebel was out, okay? But we picked a name that was beautiful, and that was before Whitney Houston was anybody, okay? I want you to know that. So we named her, and we loved that name, and so I went to work. And I knew that the name Whitney comes from the white, and I told her about the Old Testament passage where he make, though our sins be as scarlet, he makes us white as snow. And Whitney was okay with that. But I've been conscious of that from that time on, that this kind of thing matters. Later on for Whitney, whenever she was a teenager, and I'm telling you, as rebellious, I think I could say this out loud because she will agree with me, about as rebellious as a young woman can possibly be, I would say to her, "Whitney, you have leadership ability. In fact, you have gifts. I know how you understand even the Bible stories we have." I said, "You would make a very good pastor someday." And she laughed and laughed and laughed at me. You know, in her 30s, she has come back to Christ. And she leads Bible studies and teaches and is discipling people. She's very effective with women in that with all of her rebellion against all things in her life growing up. And I would meet, you know, I'd go to school and I'd meet with teachers who say that all they could see is fire in her eyes, you know. And I would meet with them and they'd tell me about that. And now I see she works unbelievably hard in helping women that she's in touch with to honor the men that are in their lives. You know that's only the miracle of Christ working in us that lets that kind of balance take place. All right, that's the first thing I remember growing up. Second thing I remember growing up was a little later on in my life, I'm hanging out with Sally. Sally had two little children. When I met them, they were 4 and 2. And when I started hanging out with Sally an awful lot, they were 6 and 4. And Erin is her daughter, and at that time she was 4, maybe 5, and she was showing me her stuffed animal that she had been playing with. I can't remember if it was a Christmas present or what it was. And she showed me the stuffed animal, and I said to Erin, "Oh, what is his name?" And she scowled at me, I picked up on it. She says, "Larry, it's a girl." It never dawned on me that a stuffed animal might be female. Did you get what's going on here? I want to tell you, those two young women changed my life because they ask the innocent questions and see the world differently from what the gender bias that I was seeing the world in. And I'm here to tell you, I still probably struggle in all these areas, but I'm getting better. And I'm realizing that though I was unconscious of that, how many times have we possibly squelched women, young ladies, older ladies, who are been called by God to a task or to a ministry or to a particular project, have we squelched in some shape or form because they have gotten the message, whether it's overt or covertly, that they are really to be silent in this particular area? Now, I understand, and I think before this series of messages is over, we'll address the passage in Timothy where Paul is telling them that the women were not to be teaching or in authority over men. We'll address that. But we're familiar with that passage, and that's out there, and we understand that. And I'm not doing away with that in any shape or form. What I am doing is lifting up all the other areas in the scripture, and there's so many more where God uses women in a powerful way and sets them free to be his agents whenever everything he did. So having said that, maybe that makes sense to you. Still, as I keep this book before you, I always read what the copyrights things say we're allowed to do, and we're allowed to do short quotes. And so I'm going to stretch a short quote here, if I can, just a little bit. Again, this is a book called Why Not Women by Lauren Cunningham and David Joel Hamilton. One of the things that I think were interesting was what he had learned along with his wife. He says that he was in Lauren, by the way. He was in the capital city of a certain nation where I learned about a vital prayer movement that had been led by women in one of the homes. The women had prayed for various leaders and had seen dramatic results. The prime minister's wife came to know the Lord. Several members of the cabinet had come into this very house where women were praying and had given their lives to Jesus. Then the prayer movement stopped. And why? Some people had begun to teach in the country that women must not be in public ministry. And they said that women couldn't have prayer meetings unless a man was present. How many of you ladies have a fine impossibility of finding a man to come with you at a prayer meeting anyway? You know what I'm talking about, don't you? They taught that women were more likely to become deceived than men. This should just make your skin crawl, by the way. The women agreed to this, but none of the men ever showed up to give them covering. The prayer meetings were canceled, and effective work of the Holy Spirit was stopped. One of the things that have held back the kingdom business for generation after generation is that whenever men feel like they needed to be in charge of that type of thing, but they don't have the heart for God that many times the ladies have had. And so because of that, they never, you know, this idea of providing a spiritual covering is almost a joke, because the men will not, many times will not do what it is that they're called to do in the first place. And so because of that, women have been squelched in so many ways. Let me see just a couple other statistics to let you know how dangerous it is to be a woman. I know you girls know this, by the way, but I just want you to let you know that we're paying attention here as well. Countries that are based on biblical principles, even if though they're eroded, women do fare better than in countries where they're not built that way. But even here in North America, in the United States, and the statistics I'm going to share here now are more than 20 years old, because the book has been around since 2000. But I still think that they speak volumes for you. And just hear me out here, will you? Probably at this time, and I hear the numbers are still very similar, by the way, that whenever women do the same job that a man might do, at best he earns about 74% of what the men's salary would be. Added to the fact that probably about 400,000 teenage women were going to give birth to children without the father participating in raising that child. More than 100,000 women were expected to be raped in the United States that year. And then approximately one in every three girls was sexually abused before she grows to maturity, right? And that just sounds astounding to me. But listen to some of the stats that came out from World Vision at that time. 450 million women are physically impaired due to childhood malnutrition. Women make up half the world's population, but own just 1% of its wealth. A girl is twice as likely not to be educated as a boy. And 2 million girls, mostly in Africa and the Middle East, are mutilated through female circumcision. Time magazine reported this, so we're not just talking about Christian publications. Time magazine reports this: in Brazil, it's justifiable homicide to kill an unfaithful wife. In Russia, the woman's office job can include having to sleep with a boss. In India, a husband and his parents sometimes conspire to kill his young bride after they have collected her dowry, freeing the young man to marry again and get another dowry. There are at least 6,000 cases a year of that, and it was growing. There is no good news in that, is there? And I always remind myself that it is in the arrival of Jesus Christ that this begins to turn. But even Jesus, with all of his authority, does not just wipe out all the evil in the culture. He, by his spirit, as the Holy Spirit has done work and teaches the truth, we continue to do away with the things that hurt the very kingdom of God and hurt the very heart of God. All right, so I just give you a little bit of idea where we're going. So that brings me to the passage of scripture today that we're working in Acts, and that's about Rhoda. Rhoda is actually a Greek word. It's on the front of your bulletin as well, and it means rose. I have a granddaughter named Lily Rose, and I think I just have to write to her and remind her of this famous woman, Rhoda, who was there. Now, for us, if any of you, Rhoda is someone who belongs on Mary Tyler Moore, or Rhoda is someone with a spinoff. In fact, one of my favorite Rhoda quotes whenever she did her own television show was she was talking about how many people had hurt her. She said, sometimes I just want to get about 10,000 people in Shea Stadium and standing out on pitcher's mound and say, okay, everybody, start apologizing, all right? So she had this great way of being able to interact and deal with the things she was dealing with. But Rhoda comes right from the heart of Scripture. Again, it was a Greek word. And what I thought we would do is we'd just take a look at this passage. You probably all have read this before, and we gloss over it because it gets lost in the fact that it's about Peter. But I just thought we would go through this. I have a picture here of the angel that had come to release Peter. This is from the television series AD, and it was a follow-up on AD. It wasn't the first one on AD. It was the second one put out on AD. And this particular angel doesn't have wings, and this angel actually has some armor and is treated like a warrior from God, okay? And again, this is all interpretation. Don't get too hung up on one way or the other. But you can see the glory. There's just a presence around him. And obviously, we believe the presence of God. So here's what happens. And just leave that up there for a second. At the time of... Here's where this fits in the book of Acts. When you read in the book of Acts, chapter 2, you read about the Pentecost. And when you get to chapter 6 and 7, you read about Stephen and his martyrdom. You take a look at Acts chapter 8, and you see the Ethiopian eunuch is baptized. Then in 9 is the conversion of Saul, Paul. And just great reading when you get into that. You start to read about Cornelius and Peter in 10, and a little bit as moves into 11 as well. And now we get to chapter 12. So this is still in the post-resurrection period. I don't know the exact amount of time, but it was a time in which the apostles were in charge, and Peter was one of the known leaders. Peter is arrested. Why? Because Herod had already arrested James, the brother of John, not James, the brother of Jesus, James, the brother of John, had arrested him and had put him to the sword, killed him, and executed him. And he saw how the Jewish officials loved the fact that he had done that. So now he has Peter arrested. So what do you think the mood of everybody was at that point? James has been killed. Peter's arrested. And everything's about ready to fall apart for all of them. The persecution is on, and it's on at a big time. So here's Peter. He's in prison. And while he's in prison, the angel comes. And of course, the angel is just present in that place, has walked by all the guards. And if you read the scripture, if you picked up on that, we find that you have to read this earlier in chapter 12, and you'll want to read this for yourself. But then Herod had assigned four squads of four soldiers each to guard Peter. how many guards would it take to keep you? To keep you in prison at the moment, okay? So there's 16 guards assigned to that. And not only that, so there's some outside the prison, some inside the prison. And there were two on either side of Peter, and then Peter was chained to the walls. The angel comes in. He removes the chains from Peter, and he has to wake Peter up. I just find this to be just staggering in my mind. He wakes Peter up, and he says, Peter, get dressed. I want you to get dressed and throw your cloak over you and follow me. And I got to believe Peter's saying, this is quite a dream, you know? And as he begins to walk out, the guards are asleep. There's no awareness of that. And the gate opens up and they go out. I have another image here of what it would have liked for Peter to see as he's walking right out of the place. And the guards outside were asleep. And he walks out and the scriptures talk about feeling a little bit like a trance to him. And when he walks out of that place, all of a sudden then the angel leaves him. And Peter he really wakes up and he thinks, oh my, I'm not in jail. I've been set free. So what does he do? He goes where he knows believers gather all the time. And he goes to the home of Mary. Now, there are lots of Marys we read about. Would you not agree? This is the Mary who's the mother of John Mark. John Mark is the one who went with Paul and Barnabas and traveled with them on the first missionary journey. Partway through that, from out in Cyprus, he had come back. And he went and he stayed right at... came back home, and of course, Barnabas was supportive of him, and Paul felt betrayed and could not trust him in the future. So this is who we're talking about. John Mark's mother, Mary, owned a pretty nice house, and maybe we got a picture of this right here. This is one of the most free. There are so many art pictures of Peter knocking on that door, but Peter travels to where he knew it was like a known bed and breakfast, where you could be sure that believers were gathered whenever they're in Jerusalem. And he knocks on the door. Now, the irony of this is he has just walked out of prison. Chains have fallen off. He's gone past 16 guards. And he finally gets to where the believers are. And he's got a knock on the door and he can't get in. I read more than one commentator that just breaks out in laughter as they think about what this is like. He knocks on the door. And a servant girl by the name of Rhoda. Rhoda worked for Mary. And you want to talk about the dignity of the working place. Let me just talk about the pecking order that was in Rome at that time, or the Greco-Roman world. And, of course, the emperor and the government officials would be at the top, Senate. You move on down to the things till you get to the artisans, till you get to the freemen and those that are... those that were citizens of Rome, and keep on moving on down in the hierarchy until you get down to the slaves, male slaves, and then finally you get down to women. Women were at the bottom of the hierarchy. Free women at the bottom of the hierarchy. That was Rhoda. You and I are sitting here 2,000 years later, talking about a woman who was at the bottom of the rung and the impact that she has, and we remember her 2,000 years later. She comes to the door, and I'm assuming that he's knocking, and while he's knocking, I'm sure she said, "Who is it?" or some type of thing, and whatever he spoke, she recognized his voice. This is really cool. It brings back just memories of Jesus saying, "My sheep hear my voice," right? And I understand how we can sense the presence of Jesus because we recognize each other's voice. There are a whole lot of you, if you'd begin to share in the middle of the church service, we'd know exactly who you are by what your voice is. She had heard Peter preach. She knew he was one of the leaders. She knew that it was someone that she trusted and loved to hear teach and preach. And she heard his voice outside the door. She got so excited that she just left the door and went back to tell everyone, "Peter's outside the door. I hear his voice." And while they get in there, they saw, they thought just what we say all the time. "You're being kind of emotional, Rhoda. Get it together." How many times have we said that to someone? Okay, you're hearing something. Then there's always a spiritual person that says, "Well, maybe that's his angel that's out there." Always someone likes to say things like that. And finally she said, "No, it's really him." Well, they said, "Well, don't leave him out there if that's the case. Just go." So they go back to the door with her because you didn't want to open your door to anybody. If the disciples are being arrested now and put to death, and this is where so many of the believers were staying when they're in Jerusalem, you didn't just open the door to anybody. You wanted to make sure that everyone was safe. And when they open the door and they see Peter, just astonishment. So the servant girl was right. The lowest on the rung that day in that house, the one who worked on the food, the one who did the laundry, the one who did whatever was being asked from Mary. She was right. She had heard the voice of that leader and at the same time wanted everyone to come, and they came. And so when they opened up the door, you know, there was a lot of buzzing. They were rather loud. Peter had to shush them up a little bit, had to have them keep quiet because this was dangerous business. In fact, Peter didn't understand what was going on, did he? How could he have? All he knew was he was free. And so he begins to share with them, and he tells them to make sure they tell the other leaders of the church, the other apostles, what had happened. And then he leaves, and he moves on. And that's the last we hear about Rhoda. Rhoda reminds me of the countless women that I've known in church that never had a leadership position, that never called attention to themselves, and yet were the salt of the earth, were the backbone of the prayer meetings that I'd been to, were the ones who had prepared and served others whenever no one, when many people never understood. She was the very one that stays in the church after everyone goes home and is still washing the dishes. She's the one who, after everyone in church has gone on, still gets the vacuum out and begins to take care of things for the church. That's Rhoda that we remember 2,000 years later. And I believe there are roses everywhere around us right at this moment. Some of you are just gifted leaders, and we acknowledge that as well. But I want to this day begin this series of messages by talking about the Rhodas, the ones that almost are not noticed in some shape or form, and what it is that God is doing in their lives. So let me just summarize it. We got a picture of the door knocking. No, I want to go back to the other one here. I want that picture of the rose at that point. Here's what I think about Rhoda. She's had the job of a servant, and she did her job. In the midst of doing her most basic responsibilities, she was the doorkeeper of letting Peter back into the body of Christ. How many of you have served as greeters here at the doorway? Sometimes your name is in the bulletin, sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's in the messenger, sometimes it's not. But how many of you have done that very, very task where you are the one at the door? You are the one that's receiving whoever it is that God is bringing through the door. I celebrate that, male and female, of any of you who ever help us with that very ministry. And I really love the fact that she knew the voice of the leader. She understood that it was Peter and that something big was getting ready to happen. Whenever no one else believed that, she was stuck saying, "I know he's at the door." I also appreciate the fact that she is the one that brings the others to the door in order to receive Peter again. Now I got to the last image here. Keep it before you as well. There are three places in the scripture where I think of knocking, and there probably are more, but in the New Testament, I think of three real quick. And I'm sure before the day is out, you will remind me of other knocking that takes place in the scripture. But these ones are just are no-brainers and even easy for me. Of course, this one where Peter knocked on the door and Rhoda answers. There's also Jesus at the Sermon on the Mount where he says, "Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find, and knock and it shall be opened to you." So there is this concept of knocking that's timeless that we remember. Doesn't sound like wood, does it? But it'll have to do. And then, of course, the one that you see right before you, Revelation 3:20. If you're close to my age, all you can think is the King James. "Behold," but NIV says, "Here I am. I stand at the door and knock," says Jesus. Rhoda, will you open the door? Mary, will you open the door? One name after another. Put your name in there if you will. Jesus stands at the door and knock, ladies. Will you open the door? Will you let him allow you to become what you have been called to do from the very beginning? There are many things I like about Titusville First United Methodist Church, but the quality of some of our ladies that are involved in teaching is just such a comfort to me. It really is. If you could just picture Jesus knocking on the door. Now, that's a salvation message. We usually tie that passage of Revelation in. But I believe he would have us open the door for whatever he is having you and me do, and whatever he's having us learn, and whatever we're trying to accomplish. Today we remember Rhoda and how God used this servant girl in this powerful, powerful way. So we're going to end this service a little bit differently than what we do. I'm going to invite the worship team to come. And we're going to be singing a resurrection song today. You know the song, In the Garden? And just a reminder to you, you can find it in your hymnal in 314. And we're going to prove that guitars and drums and keyboards can play this song even in late 30. And but if you look at that particular song, any chance we can see the first verse up there? I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. And the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. That's a picture of the garden on the day of the resurrection. And it's not the men that were there at that time. This really comes from Mary, a different Mary as well. It comes from Mary who was there. And she has seen that the tomb is empty. And then she hears the voice of Jesus, the Son of God. It's disclosed to her. She finds out who this is. And the message is that she walks with him and talks with him. But every time you sing this song, and this is a song that my older friends ask for all the time when we do funerals, or if you ask them what their favorite song is. And you need to remember this day that this song is about one of the great women of faith. It's not about Rhoda. Don't let me confuse you here. But it's about one of the women who responded the most quickly. You know, there's another hymnal in our... another song in our hymnal that talks about the first one ever. And there's three or four verses that talk about how women were the first ones to experience so many things that God had done. So during these next weeks coming, it's not that we are honoring women, but during these next weeks, right through Mother's Day, right through most of May here, we're going to be lifting up some of the women in the scriptures. And for most of them, they're ones I don't preach on as often. But the one on Mother's Day, you'll recognize that story, I think, a little bit better than others. But we'll get to hear what it is that God was doing with women. In fact, I can say this. Next week, we're going to talk about Abigail and the impact that she had made around her husband, Nabal, and David himself. So we'll take a look at that. If you decide to read up on that, you'll enjoy that. But here's how I'd like to end this now as we sing that song. I wondered if I could ask you ladies to stand up. Would you be willing to stand up? Yes, no. Then do it. Thanks for showing some leadership there, Becky. You know, nothing puts pastor in place real quickly when you ask, and they may not do it. thank you for accommodating me at that point. Guys, I wondered if you'd just be willing to extend your hands towards the ladies that are in your area as we pray for them. Could we do that right now? That they would understand their spiritual gifts, that they would understand the authority that they have as one of the children of God to serve in whatever way God has asked them to serve. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, I give you thanks for the women, for the children, for the young girls as well as the oldest of our girls. Give you thanks for them, Lord, for the giftedness that you've given them, for the spiritual gifts that you've blessed them with. And the full range of gifts are in them. And I'm asking, Lord, that you set them free to become the women you've called them to be, that you would allow some of them to be the leaders that they're called to be, others to be in maybe lesser roles. But either way, Lord, in your economy, every one of them is precious to you. And we as the men of this congregation, Lord, are asking that you help us to see them the way you see them, with all their giftedness, with all their grace, the nurturing ability that they have that we sometimes just don't have a ghost of a chance for. We give you thanks. And we simply pray, Lord, that you will let them begin to be infectious with all the people that are around them, that your kingdom would flourish, and that we gentlemen would not be found grieving the Spirit and squelching what it is that you're wanting to do in their lives and how you want to use them and impact us as well. All this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to ask if all would stand as we sing this song together.
If you're wanting to follow along, it is on page 314. And I think we ought to use this opportunity. If you know how to sing parts, let's sing parts with this song. Okay, in the garden.
Come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry.
I was looking at that third verse and seeing how Mary would have gladly stayed in the garden with him, even when the darkness was coming. You know, her flashlight was not very good. Her safety would not have been very good. And yet she would still rather have been in the presence of Jesus than anywhere else. Maybe that will be the theme as we move through these next few weeks. By the way, 2 weeks from today is Mother's Day. Because of the nurturing way, because you ladies are the ones who make things happen in the families many times, would you consider just inviting people to be with you on that day? Many of your children and your grandchildren, just by you asking, would honor you by being able to be in this place as we celebrate and we keep bringing the fact of how God has made us male and female. And it was very good. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.